wasn't because you would have like
no charges would be pressed.
I felt like you enjoyed it.
It's one of those ones.
But during,
is that because you're intimidated by my sexual prowess or what?
No, not that. Maybe it's because I'm intimidated by your ability to shut me down whenever you feel the need. And my only way of...
I was just talking to Lee about...
shutting people down.
And
my only means of defence that makes sense to me in terms of, you know, not getting serious is...
Yeah. Well, welcome to Them Drunk Blokes Talk Shit episode.
We've made
real good progress.
I did not want to be the person between these two at that time.
Well, you was.
We have been recording for the last 55 seconds. So,
so your thoughts are everyone's.
So, right. Welcome. Go sit in a fucking pub, you cunt.
Hey man, I was there all day yesterday.
Yesterday. Spirit.
Drunk blokes, oh won't you come and be a drunk bloke? We've got some sherry from the little bargain bin, where girls with baby cars shop in their pyjamas. Chaps. Drunk blokes, oh come and listen to them drunk blokes. The only one recorded in a motorhome, with Pumbaa making tea, spiked with whiskey. Drunk blokes, you're probably already a drunk bloke. In which case, let's sit down and see what happens next. We don't think that they've got arrested yet, or banned from any public events this year.
Welcome to Them Drunk Blokes Talk Shit. There's a lot of us here today, a lot of people are very drunk. We've been to a Comic Con all day.
Oh yeah!
Some people went on prior days and done fuck all, but we're in the studio. Reconnaissance Friday.
I've done more than you did on Friday, that's for sure.
Right, so, in the studio with me today, we have...
Lefty Nohan, boom, ketchup.
Ketchup for the soul.
Dope.
I am a person who is made of... cheese.
We're back from his months-long tour all over the fucking world, fucking up his hand. His DDB voice guy.
That's
and
me.
And for the first time ever, DDB voice guy has met our very own DDB comics guy.
Hello.
Why, hello, sir.
It's been a long time in coming.
It has, and I have not stopped.
The floor is sticky. And we also have with us DDB voice guy's younger brother, Dickface.
Hello.
Now, this episode is going to be filled with inserts and segments and shit from Comic-Con and us talking generally about what we saw and did over the last 3 days. We are all very pissed and stuff, apart from obviously the teetotaler.
It's true, we duffed stuffs.
We've done stuffs. So, what did we do? So, I was at work sort of all of Friday and I sent our very own... Lefty Nohans and voice guy down to the con. What did you get up to on Friday, guys?
Fuck off.
And you'll be able to tell that by the amount of videos we're about to release.
Yeah, so you took a total of 10 pictures?
No, there's more than that. I've got a lot on my GoPro thingy and on my phone and whatnot. And
oh yeah, so you've got a GoPro and you took the GoPro down there.
Yeah,
so
I took that down there and I didn't have it on my head and whatnot like I did today. I was actually holding it around and doing stuff with it. So yeah, got quite a lot recorded.
Recorded, and then you went and sat in the park, right?
Yeah, it was
a mistake. I was at work. Fucking 11 o'clock at night.
Well, we was at work as well.
Yeah, not doing fuck all.
Nah, ain't my fault it's a Friday.
I definitely was not working.
Right, so you went down there. Yes. You arranged a few interviews that we've done today.
That's right.
You scoped the place out, but not a lot was open, I understand, on a Friday. It was a bit dead.
It was... Yeah, kind of dead.
Everything was open. We could have done all the interviews we wanted. There was hardly anyone there.
We had all the time that we needed in the world.
And you did fuck all.
Well, there was an off-licence close. It was an off-licence
day. It weren't fucking close. We went in a day. It was half an hour walk away.
It was close for us.
And that was a Sunday on a bank holiday.
Yeah.
May I add?
No.
So, we ended up getting there, having a little look around, scattered the land, abused some young Jedis, telling them that they were going to die.
Yeah, well, they didn't die because, like, about 4 hours later, the same people were there training. Yeah. Training away.
Anakin didn't do his fucking job then, did he?
No. Anakin cunt. Didn't even turn up.
What?
There's some other trainer there going, yeah, you're going to do great in the afterlife.
Are you saying that quietly? Yeah, he was there today, but there weren't no young Jedi.
He still hadn't killed anyone on the final day of MCM Comic Con.
Right.
So, they
went there, they'd done that, and they'd done some things. You can go to either the normal page or Facebook.
Hang on. We done VR.
You done some VR? Explain the VR. What happened in the VR?
Right, so it was a Jurassic Park themed area. There was
Jurassic World, that's right. And
coming June 6th.
Oh, come on.
That's what you're here for, information.
And with the Jurassic World stuff, they were handing out special edition posters, which at the end of it, no doubt.
We've got a little giveaway, so stay tuned. We'll work something out.
But yeah, bowled in there, and we're the first people, actually, to try the VR.
The first two of the entire MCM Comic Con event to try out the shitty fucking.
Yeah,
VR.
It didn't work.
Hey, yeah.
You mean it was an interactive Goldblum?
It was
Goldblum. It was Goldblum.
To start off with, it was fucking Oculus.
Not even Vive.
We know it's shit. There's some Oculus, and they didn't call it Oculus Rift, they call it Oculus like.
Reparo.
Yeah, some like beta. Bullshit. Hey. So we stuck the goggles on. They was like, yeah, I'll click this thing when you look at the thing. We clicked the thing when you look at the thing. It was like, I'm going to take that off you now. So all we did was sit there and just
literally
look at it.
Oh, right. So it was just a VR experience. It wasn't a game. It was sit in the middle of something.
You sat there. So the premises is that there was blue from the.
Oh, the Raptor.
And you were barely
and blue is at
it.
The bottom of the volcano, what you've probably seen on the trailers already. If you have seen the trailers, then there's a big volcano and it blows up.
Oh, yeah, because it basically does like second Jurassic Park film where they escape to. Manhattan or whatever.
That's it.
So they're just rebooting that, but obviously there's a megalodon.
So basically, you get on the VR, you start off, you're looking at a raptor, it disappears, a triceratops appears, the raptor reappears, the volcano explodes, it's the end of the fucking experience.
And it finishes.
You didn't even get the velociraptor from Jurassic Park 3 just come up to you and go, Alan. What a letdown.
So we got up there.
Didn't even get to go, clever girl.
Didn't get to pretend you're in a helicopter and just do the golf run off.
Stay away from your lighthouse. So Chaz, what was your overall experience with the VR?
Out of 10, I would give it a 3.
Right, and Lefty?
A sturdy 3.
But with that in mind, we all have played the Vive in other games, which are 10 times better.
Like,
if you had never done a VR experience before.
Had I have expected it to be a non-interactive VR, I would have given it a higher score. But because I was like, oh, we're going to do something in this. Right? Mm. Like, we got in there, they sat us down on chairs.
Chairs? They sat us on a fucking chair.
Not even gaming chairs, just like office fold-out chairs.
Wait, there shouldn't have been any chairs in there in the fucking first place. Right?
There should have been virtual chairs. You should have sat on virtual chairs.
Yeah.
They didn't even give you a remote or anything handheld.
They should have asked you before you went in there.
Anyway.
Yeah, I know, exactly.
Before you
they didn't explain anything to us.
Yeah.
They just was like, oh, you want to do VR? We were like, yes, we want to do VR. They were like, here you go, put this on.
My speaker's buggered.
I think the only explanation I got from anything was, put it on from the front to the back.
Okay.
And obviously, I put one leg through and the other leg through.
And the balls rested firmly on the screen. Yeah.
Nothing was happening. At the very least,
At
the very least, they should have asked you if you were adept at squatting.
Yeah. Or they should have asked me what my gender pronoun was.
Yeah. See, yeah. Like,
that's a big issue for me.
Are you a Z?
Or a Z?
Or a Z?
Right. So anyways, that was the first day. So and then you went out from the VR experience and did what?
Right, so we started scouting the land and came across this steampunk section. Which was quite good, actually. They had like R2-D2s and the gin hat, which...
Yeah, the gin hat. We put some pictures up of all this stuff.
They had various little insects and arachnids and stuff made out of like...
Meccano, as far as I worked out today.
Yeah, that was a little bit kind of...
they weren't Meccano there.
No, what I'm saying is you arranged an interview... Yeah. With the guy that run the Steampunk Emporium, correct?
Yes.
And we went there today and he was on stage talking about how he makes his shit from Meccano.
Yeah.
And this guy was so fucking boring that we walked away and didn't give him an interview.
Yeah, that was kind of how it went as well. And then I saw the...
I liked him.
I make stuff, so I am classified as a maker.
Doesn't surprise me that much.
But I saw him on stage yesterday.
No.
Oh, no, through the app. And he was doing this main stage talk about how we like
a bit more into it. Yeah, because today it was boring as fuck.
Oh, yeah, it was really
and we actually walked away. And, I feel a bit guilty like walking away, but obviously, as Supreme Overlord, Shogun Saddam of Pumba, I decided that that wasn't the interview to have.
Ayatollah Pulmini.
Pulmini. Ayatollah. Fucking grass is like a carpet. Right, so, yeah, you went there, you did that, and then where else did you go that day? You scrapped out what was left?
Yeah, we were checking out the artists, there was the whole artist section, so we went up and down throughout all the artists.
Yeah.
I mean, it's predominantly anime, it's predominantly...
rip-offs.
Digital artwork, and it's predominantly fan art of other people.
See, as a comic fan, I always feel like I'm going through a comic shop graveyard when I walk through.
They'll
look at you like, please, sir.
And then, like, throughout the whole thing, there's, like, two or three, maybe, that are reasonable artists, you know? Or unless you know what you're looking for, and then it's like... Because, obviously, me and Lee... We personally don't read a lot of comics and stuff like that. Like, we read a couple of comics, but we're not, like, really into it. So we're walking through and we have no idea what we're looking at most of the time. But I'm being an artiste.
Can tell you that shit.
And criticising everyone you come across.
Yeah, so ultimately critical. That's not being an artiste. That's just being a cunt in general. But, like, looking at stuff and going, oh, that is actually some good shit.
Yeah.
So we found this guy who was like he was doing his own comics. I don't know about the writing.
Okay.
I didn't read any of it. I just looked at the artwork.
So this is
Bruno Stahl.
Yeah. So you saw the artwork of Bruno Stahl.
His comics that he was promoting were called The Hands.
Yeah, The Hands. And if I think this is a perfect time, obviously to say we went back today and spoke to Bruno himself.
Yeah.
And we got some audio. From him, you interviewed him about his work, correct?
I did, yeah.
You did. So what we'll do is we're going to splice that in now.
We've got some visuals too.
We've got some visuals. We'll put that on the Facebook pages. Obviously, this is an audio podcast, Dickface. Like, obviously, we can't show people visuals through this.
Just use your imagination.
Can I just say one little thing? Fuck you, listener.
Ignore him. Okay. Ignore him and enjoy DDB voice guy talking to Bruno Stahl.
Well, hello there.
All right.
Right, go.
Hey. It's DDB Voice Guy here for Dem Drunk Blokes, presenting Lefty No Hands, and this guy over here.
Hello.
We're interviewing today, Bruno Hands, Bruno
Stahl.
Let's start that again, shall we? DDB presents Ketchup for the Soul, featuring DDB Voice Guy, Lefty No Hands, this guy. And today we're interviewing Bruno Stahl.
How's it going, guys?
So, you, sir, are a comic book writer and artist.
Yeah, I would describe myself more like a storyteller, you know. And I wouldn't call myself a writer. I just like use my writing so I can like illustrate the kind of comic books I would like to read. So, like, the art comes first, you know?
So, earlier when I spoke to you, you said that some of it was partially inspired by, what's the guy's name? This one here, these demons?
Oh, like H.P. Lovecraft.
Lovecraft.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I kind of, I like the cosmic horror, you know, like the bleakness of the Lovecraft stories, and it's like a fertile ground, like for this kind of creatures, you know, like a kind of horror that I grew up watching back in the 80s.
Is it like specifically kind of like sci-fi horror, or is it more like, I mean, what kind of style is this? Like,
it's mishmash of like sci-fi, like fantasy, yeah. You know, horror, you know, but there's always the horror, the horrific element, you know.
Yeah.
It's kind of like the stuff like Guillermo del Toro is doing amazingly nowadays, you
yeah.
know, like I'm really into that approach, yeah. You know, like to...
Like, he really piqued my interest when I watched Pan's Labyrinth.
Oh, yes.
I was like, that's an amazing bit of horror fantasy going on
yeah.
there.
And I'm a huge fan of like the practical effects guys. You
yeah.
know, Rick Baker, Rob Bottin, he's my artistic hero, you know.
Yeah.
So I got more influence from movies than I actually had from comics.
Oh, right.
So what I tried to do with the hands was exactly to apply.
This is it. Yeah.
To apply the same approach those guys like back in the 80s would apply to, like, you know, like when I design my creatures I try to get this like a practical effect guy's mindset, you know, like
yeah.
if it would be like a practical
so
in
as
real
if
life.
You're actually making it,
yeah,
so you're like what's it like, so you can envision what it's going to look like from every
yeah.
possible angle.
Yeah, if I had to like build a doll or something, you know, like prosthetics,
yeah.
makeup,
yeah.
How would that work out in reality? You know,
so
like,
did you do any of that before you started doing the painting and drawing, or
a lot of concept art, and even I've done a sculpture of the hands.
Yeah,
but like it's been
too much to bring here.
Yeah, no, yeah, I couldn't bring with me now. It's kind of huge, you know, like it's more or less this size.
And you you showed me earlier. You showed me your originals for the for
right,
the,
yeah.
itself. So you paint all of them. It's oil, is it, or is it acrylic?
Acrylics.
So you do
yeah.
acrylic on these panels, which are about about this big, this size, right?
Yeah, more or less this size. Yeah.
And you, how many per book is that?
Sorry,
how many do you have to do per book?
Depends, because like I let like the story to grow like organically, you know.
Yeah.
So I don't have like exactly a page count for the book. Like the first issue is like 22 pages, the second is 34, and the final chapter is probably going to be something around 50 pages. I don't know. Yeah.
Wow.
You know, I let it open so I can like come up with ideas
yeah.
whilst I'm working on
yeah,
it.
Yeah, you
know?
So you don't know what the finished product is. You've got sort of like an idea for the story and it just grows organically.
Yeah, I know how it ends.
You yeah,
know?
You know how it ends.
That's it. You know,
and then
everything between is just
going to fill in there.
Yeah, yeah.
Beautiful. And so what is this character? What's it about? What's going on with it?
Well, the Hans tells the story of this young boy named Arthur, whose father is dying of cancer, so he finds like a refugee in his own fantasy world, which is like the world of the hands. So he's the one actually working on a comic book called The Hands.
Right.
So you got like the two realities.
So it's
like
a little bit meta as well.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. The story within the story.
So is it sort of like, is there some inspiration from your own life there as well? So obviously you're writing a comic book, he's trying to write a book. Is that something
yeah,
that's
yeah.
going on there? Like,
yeah, yeah. There's some personal stuff in there, and I wanted also like to comment upon the creative process of comics. You know,
right.
Exactly what you just say. Like,
yeah.
You know, like to try to show people where the inspiration comes from.
Yeah.
You know, like how you get to that result.
Yeah. So in the book, is it coming from his own popular culture in his world that he's getting this inspiration for his writing in there, or?
Yeah, because like Arthur, like the character, he basically watched the same movies I watched when
right.
I was a kid. So
yeah.
Yeah, you got like a bit of my own background.
So it's post-apocalyptic.
Yeah,
and it's set in the real world, or like a version of what is
no,
like the real world.
The Hans world is like a post-apocalyptic. You
yeah,
know? It's being taken over by this Lovecraftian entities.
Right.
Which, like, you could say stands for, like, as a metaphor for the Arthur's father of cancer, you know?
Right.
So, yeah, you got a bit like this kind of subtext to the story as well.
And so is it like, is this actually happening? Or is it just a part of his mental, like, dealing with what's happening to him?
Yeah, I couldn't tell it without spoiling the whole thing.
Ah, something's done there.
Yeah. Ah, so that's...
You need to wait for the final chapter,
awesome.
You know, the third issue.
Awesome. And so these are the first two issues here,
yeah.
Already done.
Yeah.
So this is the first one, is it?
Yeah, the first one.
And, like, it's set... Like, his father dies during this or after?
Oh, no, not yet.
his father hasn't even died yet?
No, not yet.
His father's still...
That was like a spoiler.
Yeah. Dun, dun, dun. Awesome. Okay, and what about these pieces? What are they from? What's going on here?
Well, this is like... The music of Eric Zahn is based on the H.P. Lovecraft short story. It's like one of my favorites. Ivana Hyde is like a new comic series that I'm working with Ivana. Like, she's a model.
Right.
We are working together on this new comic series that probably is gonna come out before the final chapter of
so
the
you've
Hans.
Got a few products a few projects that are on the,
yeah.
on the cards at the moment.
Yeah, I'm working on both at the same time.
Wow.
And I'm going mental right now.
I bet, man. So you're like, you're pretty much painting non-stop.
Yes. Painting and writing and like listening to music.
Yeah.
And watching movies, that's all.
Yeah, nice. So it's like I don't know about you, but when I'm doing it, it's kind of like a bit like meditation.
Right.
You know, so
yeah,
it's
yeah.
like you just get in, you kind of have an idea of what's happening, and then it organically moves on from there and like becomes something.
Yeah.
Is that how you do it, or you just, you're right in there, focused on it, or how does it really work?
It's not an easy process, you know, like sometimes you just don't want to do anything. You don't want to paint, you don't want to write, sketch, nothing, you know. Like you need to get things done. You know, so I try to find ways like how to get me in the mood, the
yeah.
right mood.
Right.
Like music helps a lot, you know.
Yeah.
Like I'm a huge fan of move soundtracks. So sometimes like I put something on and like after a couple of minutes, I okay, yeah, got
just
it.
Into the flow.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think everyone struggles with that kind of creative process.
Oh yeah, it's
yeah.
always a struggle, you know. Like
yeah.
it's not like a making cupcakes or anything, like nothing against like people making cupcakes, you know, but it's like it's a much easier process,
yeah,
know?
Yeah, yeah, obviously,
yeah, so
there's a lot more time and effort going into it,
yeah.
So these two are available now,
yes.
Where can you get them from?
Well, you can get the digital copy from Comixology.
Alrighty.
And the physical copies you can get from Comixy UK.
And how do you spell that?
Oh, yeah.
It's on here. Here we go. Have a look at this. Right, and finally, the third volume.
Yes.
When are we expecting this to be coming out?
That's a good question. No, by the end of this year, that's my deadline.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to get it done.
By the end of the year.
Yeah.
Excellent. Well, Bruno, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I appreciate
pleasure.
Your time.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, and good luck.
Cheers.
So that was Bruno Style. And what was your actual opinion about him? Obviously, not face to face. What's your review of him after this?
Personally, what you were about to go as well.
No, I think
you?
He was actually quite good. He's got a really good idea about what he wants to do with this comic and what he wants to do, like with each like chapter. He's doing three chapters of it, and he's got this idea and his artwork as well. You'll see it with the videos and that. The artwork that he does, bit by bit, and it's all hand done, and it takes a couple of hours for him to do each picture, so it's kind of
it takes him a couple of hours to draw each picture,
yeah,
then it takes him like
and then
many
to
more
to
hours
colour
to
and
shade.
Shade.
You
got
an inkist,
yeah.
a colourist
it's
as well.
It's all independent.
Oh, so it's acrylic. It's all acrylic paint, So, like, every single page you look at, he's painted the panel. So he's like literally acrylic painted the panel.
Like Alex Ross then. Like, he's the main comic artist. All his stuff is always
he's the painted. Artist and the writer and everything. Like, he does everything.
It's like when you go for a tattoo, you sit there for 20, 30 minutes and you get your outline.
Yeah.
And then you've got to book in hours to get all the detail and all the shade.
So,
and all
he does all that panel per panel, each one.
And it, on the Friday when we went there, he showed us all the panels individually.
Yeah.
Like, he got them out and I had a good look at them. And like, he's an amazing artist.
So,
like,
yeah, that's what I was trying to say. Yeah, so, really as good. An artist, how do you rate him?
Oh, I'd rate him definitely up there because his depth is...
You're not an artist. Sorry.
I mean, like,
resident artiste.
For his medium, he's absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
Like, just as general depictions of ideas and, like, you know, like, colour, focus, like, just a general outlook and the ideas that he's put together. It's beautiful. I'd really rate him.
So, and his name?
Bruno Stahl. And he's not worked for anyone else like Marvel or DC. He's all independent.
Yeah, he's completely independent.
And I don't know if you covered in the interview where we can find his work.
Yeah, I've got it here anyway. So he's got his own website, which is comixology.co.uk.
No, Comixology
that's a
multiple.
Take two.
Thank you very much.
No, we'll just leave that in.
You will also find him on Facebook.
There we go. That's probably the best place to find people these
under
days.
Bruno Stahl The Hands. And that's his it's currently in the workings, a trilogy. I think he said there's going to be 5 volumes. Did he say that? Or?
So it's a series.
Oh, it's like Hitchhiker's a trilogy in 5 parts.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that's Bruno Stahl The Hands, spelled with a B.
What? Bruno is definitely spelled with a B, yeah.
So at the moment, he's actually got 2 volumes out already of The Hands.
Yeah.
Which
It's visually impressive.
It's beautiful.
He's
working on the third one. Okay. He also has an Instagram, which is Stahl_Bruno. Okay. So Stahl is Stahl_Bruno. Bruno.
Right. So yeah, you found him. And as I said, you've heard that interview that we did today, which is 2 days later. Very nice guy. And then you walked around a bit more and you found someone else.
Yeah, another guy that we saw on Friday. From his story.
Yeah.
Gentleman Chris.
Chris Duncan, I believe.
Quite possibly.
Right, I've got his info there. So yeah, it's Chris Duncan.
From his story, what he was saying, he worked in advertising for like until he was like 30 or 35 or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was also doing bronze work, beating bronze basically. Yeah, yeah. So like he would have a thin sheet of bronze, and he would
raise the
and he would do the almost like beating profile on whatever it is.
Because I did ask him about it because there's a lot of it that's you'd think it's moulded the way that it's pressed on.
Yeah, it's very beautiful.
But it's everything that he has is just all etched in, just knocked out.
It's not etched, it's called raising. So basically what you do is you use a dome thing and a hammer, and this is how you do bronze work and make helmets and shields and shit like that. And then you just batter it and you raise the material out from the edge.
Around.
You thin it out.
Into the shape. But this guy, unlike a helmet or a hammer, I saw it today and it was amazing. He's using empty cans. So he made Yoda out of a Carlsberg tin. He's opened the tin, raised Yoda out of the tin, and it looked the tits.
The guy's got mad skills. Like, etching is when you get a surface and you dent into it.
Or scratch into it.
How many people have seen Yoda while drinking a can suddenly appear?
Well, this is the thing that he said to us when we spoke to him.
Well, this is what we were saying.
Not today, but a couple of days ago, is that there's certain cans that you can't get anymore.
Yeah.
So it's like the Carlsberg can.
Yeah, it's an old school Carlsberg can.
Like old, they've changed it recently. Hmm. But he got given one of these cans. And he doesn't just get all this material given to him himself. himself.
Yeah.
He drives, he even says in the
interview,
he drives around and he just sees rubbish on the floor and he picks it up and he has that creative mood. And like he said that he sold a Pink Panther, it's relentless to a pink can.
Yeah.
And he etched Pink Panther into it for a client. And they specifically asked for it. So, and he's even got someone from Mexico, gave him a Desperados can, that's it, and done, what's that, Speedy Gonzales.
Speedy Gonzales, yeah. The band for being too racist Warner Brothers character.
Yeah.
He done a couple of other, he done another one, some kind of jester in a Carlsberg can.
Was it the Joker?
No, no, it wasn't the Joker.
He had a hat.
It was like Harley Quinn, but green.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so it's the Mad Hatter from DC.
Carlsberg don't etch into cans.
They raise them.
If they did, they'd probably just be as shit as the beer is.
Okay, so we did go back to him today, and we did get an interview with him, with yourself. And we'll put that in now, and we'll tell you his details after. But yeah, this is for him. Chris, amazing work. And yeah, listen, enjoy.
This is DDB Voice Guy presenting Ketchup for the Soul. Here we are with Chris Duncan. Behind us you have his artwork. Tell us a little bit about what you do.
I work in sheet metals, generally either copper, tin. My more recent stuff is where I'm working straight onto discarded drinks cans, which I pick off the street, whatever. I started by using the inside of a can, but then I had to keep on explaining to punters that, you know, it was a can, so I had to cut holes in the back of the frame so they could see. But now I've started using the outside, the printed side, so you get a real pop arty feel.
Yeah, to the piece. It's the thing that actually piqued mine and Lee's interest, first of all. We were walking past and we were like, oh, look at that. That's a unique idea.
I'm fairly new at doing Comic Cons. I normally put stuff in galleries or whatever. So I'm trying to sort of my main career is I was creative director in an advertising agency.
Yeah.
So I've always done my own art a long time of career.
Yeah.
So I've been selling for years really, but now I'm trying to push it. This is my arty one because I went to art school.
Yeah.
And now I only do it like almost like a pension plan. So, and it's going down well. And we're getting a really good reaction from. Yeah. Shows like this or whatever, I'm getting a lot of repeat clients. People, a lot of the kids are into it. I get kids up to from the age of 5 up to 55, and that's my market.
Nice.
I mean, so it's either kids, hipsters, middle-aged, tattoos.
Is it a lot of like, I recognise that. Like, is it that kind of thing?
Well, I'm buying into a culture that, you know, some of the characters I do, I grew up with.
Yeah.
So I'll pick a can up. I sold a Pink Panther the other day, mainly because I found a monster pink. You can, it was on the street, it was near a quarry from me, picked it up.
So that's what I was imagining, like, so you see a can and you're like, instantly something's like, I could do that with this.
Sadly, what I do is I'll go on a run, be on a bike, even be in a car, and I'll literally pull up. If I see a can I want, I'll pull up, pick it up. So I could go on a run, come back home, and I've got a pouch full of empty cans. And I'll take them home. Sometimes I'll have a can for about 6 months before I know what to do it.
Yeah.
I'll pop in and I'll just go. Because I did this Speedy Gonzales the other day. Now I've got to remember what the can is. Remember the can is. But I picked that can up.
There's a red and yellow rock scar I can think of.
It was on some sort of tequila based drink.
Desperado.
Well done.
Yeah. Nice.
So I did it on Desperado. So
Just see it and you're like, I can do something, but I'm not sure what that is yet. And you've got a load.
Some I'll just use it as a base colour. There's a Bart Simpson I did over there, which I did on a Relentless can.
Yeah.
And I changed the R to a B and put him on it. Some I just did a Judge Dredd where he used the roundel of the Coke Zero can for his helmet.
Yeah.
And I cut into that and stuff. So some, what's the other one? That's obviously the Coke is a red can. Easy to use and it's got real good branding that comes into it and people buying
stuff as
well, so.
Yeah.
And they look great as prints. So I'm selling a lot more work going out to Europe at the moment. So
you're going to other conventions soon, or you're going to galleries or what?
Next show we're in is in Manchester. We're doing a Comic Con in Manchester.
Oh, so more Comic Cons. So
we do Comic Cons. I also do I do also art shows myself on there. And that's generally that the plan at the moment. So
Manchester Comic Con's the next one.
Yeah. We just come back from Belgium. We did Belgium. We did Ghent in Belgium.
How did that go?
It went fine. We didn't sell as much, but it's one of those things where we do generally sometimes get commissions. I know I've probably got about 4 commissions out the back of doing this show.
Right.
So, and I'm doing work for a guy in France who wants, he sent his cans over to me.
Oh,
so
wow.
I've got 6 cans all on one. So
like they're ones that he's seen and gone, I want this on it, and he just...
We've had a conversation, so it via Pigeon English, because he obviously... So he right. He sent me pictures from his supermarket with pictures of cans on.
Yeah.
And I picked the ones I wanted, and he went and bought them and drank them, and he sent them over.
Excellent.
So that's a slow drip, so he wants that the latter part of summer. So.
Yeah, wow. So like most of it isn't like that, I'm guessing. Most of it's sort of like they see something iconic that they like, they're like, wow, I'm going to have that. Are you having to try and like, this is a new thing for you?
No, it's generally sort of, selling work. I've always sold, I was a concept man in advertising business, so yeah. I'm used to going into big pictures and selling. Right. It's a bit different when it's your own work. When it's your own work, there's a humility there, but
yeah.
I'm having to get into it. But I do get an immediate reaction. I had a chap come in yesterday, he saw a Hulk, he stopped, and he said, I've got to buy it.
Yeah.
And he said, I've spent a fortune already, and he said, but I've got to buy it. And he did, he walked away. So.
I mean, that's the thing about, not to be unfair to all this out here, but a lot of it is just sort of like printed merchandise. Whereas this is like sort of like original artworks, it immediately piques your attention. Well, people are like, wow, that's something that's unique.
That's what I've been saying about is these shows are a brand. Comic-Con is a brand. I mean, I'm an ex-brand man.
Yeah.
And if you don't keep that brand fresh, these customers won't come anymore.
Yeah.
So we are getting a good reaction, and it's like, but the thing is, it's just one of those things where we think, well, we're making money at the moment, we're getting commissions on it, but at the moment, we're just balancing out whether we're going to do any more and whatever. Right. So.
Yeah.
But we've had a good time.
Oh, well, good. So you're scheduled for another one. Hopefully, if that's good, you'll keep doing this.
Yeah, we're on our second year, I think, of doing the Comic-Con circuit. Yep.
And where can our listeners / viewers, where can we find you?
Can go on my website, which is littlefingeruk.com.
littlefingeruk.com. Brilliant.
You can see all my work there. If you want anything, just give me a bell. Excellent. Email me.
Awesome. Chris, thank you very much. I appreciate
cheers.
It.
Okay,
thank
cheers.
You. Have a good day.
Cheers.
And I hope everything goes well for you in the future.
Okay,
thank you. Can Man.
Yeah, Tin Man, wasn't it? We've got to find a Tin Man.
It was a Tin Can Man.
Ah.
Boom, boom, bat.
So that was the Tin Can Man. Yeah, so you can find him at littlefingeruk.com. He's on Twitter at littlefingeruk and Instagram at littlefingeruk. Running around all over the place right now. So yeah, that was the highlight. So that was your Friday mixed with Sunday today.
Yep.
The next day you took off.
Friday was a hard day, to be honest with you. I didn't really expect it to be so drunk while doing it. So Saturday was an off day,
and then basically the next day I finished work.
I couldn't be fucked on Saturday.
I understand that.
Fuck this shit. I woke up, all these cunts are cunts, and I don't even want to be part of it.
I woke up feeling fresh as a daisy, and I was like, yes, Comic Con is today. I'm like, I'm ready. I looked at you. So over at you, and you're sitting there, and you're like playing Scrabble or some shit. Yo,
we've only 3 layers.
4. And I just looked at your face. I was like, I take it you're not going today. And you're like, nah, I've worked.
I was like, I'm gonna.
Anyway, the next day after work, I run down there to get my press pass, which wasn't a press pass.
We got great issues, apparently.
I ended up with a press pass. That's another story. So that day I went down there, rushed from work, trying to meet Lefty Nohans and DDB Voice Guy and the rest of the crew, and no one went. Luckily enough, straight out at Heroes and Villains Con came
DDB Comics Guy, out of nowhere.
Yeah, all the way from Els Court. He was at one con all morning, travelled down. Was fucked, like could be bothered to get his arse in gear, and come down and met us at the XL. So we ran in there, we flew in there. I only had 2 hours. I had to go to the 60th birthday of my mother-in-law. There was no way I could miss it. I tried. I told my missus, fuck off. She said, no, you got to go. So I went in there. I had 2 hours to kill. 2 hours not to kill, to soak it all in. It was fucking rammed. In two hours, I couldn't walk from one side to the other. There's too many people in my way, too many cosplayers. Yeah. I took like 4 pictures.
Really? Yeah, the whole day.
Although,
so you were grafting.
Man, you went there to work.
Oh, so you were grafting all day, was
so disappointed.
You get a lot of work.
You
get
any interviews. You were here for a whole 2 hours.
So I thought you went there to work.
Shut your face. So what I did was I worked my bollocks off while I was there. I wander around, I push people out of the way, people in fucking huge people in fucking Rhino fucking cosplay, I push them down to the ground and get me away!
No, we didn't get to make up a story about our Friday, did we?
You did, you just didn't choose to. It's all off the top of the dome.
Right, we're doing it today.
Right, so, we went in. I found, well, due to DDB comics guy, I found out that my greatest hero of comic book writing ever, the guy that wrote the killology of Deadpool, was there, Mr. Cullen Bunn. He said he's there. We ran around. I stalked him on Twitter to find out exactly where he was. Yeah. I took a picture of his desk and found out where the toilet was that was right next to him. I hunted him down. I walked up to the desk, bold as brass, and shat my pants.
And went in. Meatloaf and bat out of hell. I'll do anything for love. Got there and then it just went.
And you know what I did when I first walked up to him? I went, hello, sir. Hello, sir. Put my hand out, shaking like a leaf. And he went, hello. I said, so we're not here for long today, and like the guys with the mics, they're not here, but would you mind, please, tomorrow, could we have an interview with you, please, sir? And he was like, yeah, no problem. He checked his schedule. He said, I'm here all day.
Yeah, at 3 o'clock,
we've got,
like
3 o'clock, we've got a panel. 12 o'clock, I want to go on lunch. Try and get here earlier tomorrow so that there's not people, and I'll give you your time. And I was like, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Believe me, it was not easy carrying Pumba away from that.
Dragging him.
It's not easy carrying Pumba away from anything.
So we finished.
It's not easy carrying Pumba.
Full stop.
It's not easy.
Being green.
It's not easy.
So we then went off to find Daddy Big Comics guy and probably a lot of our voice of our childhood, Mr. Kevin Conroy.
Yes, Batman himself.
You managed to get something signed, I believe.
Yes, I got a figure thing signed from him because that guy was the voice of my childhood.
Yeah.
And I nearly had the Pumba moment by myself. He's like, because he was so laid back. He's like,
well, this is the thing that
talking,
like,
chatting.
The queue next to him was Tom Cox Ellis.
Yeah.
The queue for Tom Ellis had guards at the end of it because they couldn't have any more people in the queue. And Kevin Conroy at Comic Con, you'd expect that kind of queue. It was like half the length.
I was like,
what is wrong with these people here? They know nothing.
What did you actually say to him?
Oh, I proper started gushing and I started trying myself.
It just went.
Now, what did he say to you then?
No, he's like, hi there, Dan.
Did he do the Batman accent?
He drops into it for you.
Yeah.
It was like, I had, because you have to put a thing what you want on there. So I said, like, to Dan, I am vengeance. Everyone knows the quote. Kevin Conroy. So he's like, oh, hi, Dan. I was like, when I was young, I used to get picked on and you made my childhood.
Oh, man.
I was like, no, sure, I'm saying this.
How did he not hug you from
it? He's like, oh, like, cold as calm, like, look me in the eye.
Like Batman, just
he's like, happy I could help.
It's almost him putting a hand on you and just going,
it's okay.
So,
I'm here now.
Comic-Con 2 years ago, I met Kevin Eastman, who creates Ninja Turtles. I'm waiting in the queue for a picture, and he's like, oh, come over, Dan. I was like,
he knows my name.
All I could hear in my head was take my breath away.
Wait.
What was that for?
Take my breath away.
Oh, we're going to edit it in.
So he's a man of few words then, or what?
What, Conroy?
Yeah.
No, he was quite chatty. He was just speaking to him about that. It's all kind of like a blur because I was cheating. I had the person behind me taking pictures.
Try and focus it in.
Talk to him about Batman. Don't get distracted by what he's writing. And as I'm walking away, like this moment happened, he's like, oh, I was like, he wants me to be in his next animated film. Turn back. Batman, he's like, oh, it's signed in paint. make sure you let it air. I was carrying that thing like around, like hiding it, like carrying like that. Someone comes in, I was like, get away!
I need bubble wrap. I need bubble wrap.
Yeah, so I had to run while you was waiting in line. Like literally, I was in that much of a rush. But then you was there for an hour or so taking a few photos for us, just getting a picture of the general scene and everything.
Tried getting into the Nintendo area, which was
absolutely
ram.
Yeah, I noticed.
Well, even today it was a little bit ram, but compared to this, is what I was trying to explain to them yesterday, the amount of cosplayers and stuff like that, there were so many. And then today there were still loads, but fuck me, like, remember when we went last year, Chase?
Yeah, on Friday it was empty, but we just couldn't be bothered.
I was trying to cut in a bit from last year. If you want to be a cunt about it, fuck off. But we've got some audio and some pictures from last
that's
year.
That's all I know how to be.
I can't even go to do that.
Where do we go from that?
So last year we went and it was very sunny and everything else, and we did go around and we got a lot of interviews then, but they've not been released yet. They're on your memory card, your laptop, and I've got some on my phone.
Yes, indeed.
So we're going to put some of them together.
Some of them permanently destroyed by the River Thames.
By someone dipping their phone in the River Thames. The Thames didn't jump out and destroy the photos. But we're going to get them together and we'll release that probably on Facebook and YouTube as like a comparison of last year's interviews, because we got tons. And then this year...
What about the anime and gaming con? Are we going to chuck that in there too?
No, I think that should be this year, when you went at the beginning of this year. We should get that all together and put that out.
Is that this year?
Yeah.
There's not
was
a just
before you went. It's this year,
Shut up, was it?
Yeah, that's why all of it's on your laptop and you weren't in the fucking country.
Oh, yeah, because it was like, oh, just, you know, you just take it if you
there's
want.
And then Anthony had it under there.
Everyone was like, I'm not coming to your house.
Your house?
Like, if he went to a con... went to the other side of the world and then come back straight into another country.
Yeah, that's exactly what happened. I'm on the fucking fire.
Exactly what happened.
That's right. Voice by does put the legs in sometimes, not on a Saturday.
No.
So,
I don't care.
We'll have some of that stuff. And then Sunday, this morning, my only day off of the week. I got up early. I got down there, opening interview with Mr. Bun lined up as soon as it opened. Got there as it opened, and where were you?
I was watching him eating peanut butter and jam on toast.
What time was that? I was in bed. No one told me you were going. Like right now,
they didn't open until 9 o'clock. What's this guy talking about?
I was there at 9. I was sitting outside. Chosen
noodle.
20
past 8
watching him
eating peanut butter and fucking jam. That's all he ever fucking
eats. Half past 8 they were at Newby Park. Right, so what happened, Anthony was like, on Saturday or whatever, he was like, did you go yesterday? I was like, yeah. He was like, are you going today? I was like, no. He was like, you going tomorrow? I was like, yeah.
No, you said probably.
I didn't say
probably.
I didn't say probably.
Oh, we can go over this conversation.
It doesn't matter. It's not great audio.
The main
I said probably.
meaning yes, which I took as a yes.
Why is that DeadPool teleportation?
The words were probably
right.
I said probably.
So we went today. I wanted to look professional in front of Mr. Bun, my all-time hero, and Lefty's got the microphones. We did eventually when we got there.
I think you looked alright.
I was a mess. We were there. I didn't even know who this guy was, but I was like, oh, where's my camera phone thing? What's going on?
That's why I interviewed him.
And then I took some video, but partial, and it's going to look really shit. So enjoy that, guys.
But enjoy the interview that I had. The audio interview.
Like it's going to be amazing.
I was in conversation with comics book guy all morning and all yesterday, trying to arrange photos. trying to arrange questions. Loads of questions. Had loads of questions about all these different issues. I even forgot his comics when I started talking to him. I was like, and then you wrote that, and he's like, you know my comic book list as well as I do. And you're about to hear that now. So basically, to cut away from that, as I said, the greatest writer of Deadpool. Mini shorts that there's been, probably. You got Night of the Living Deadpool, the Killology, all them ones you've heard me talk about before. He's the guy responsible for it. So we're going to do a brief intersect about the Deadpool 2 movie. Straight afterwards, we'll go into the interview with Colin Bunn at MCM Comic Con. Enjoy that. Enjoy.
Right.
So here we are. This is our small segment on the new Deadpool 2 film. We said it was coming. Obviously, it was supposed to be Good, the Great, and Legonex taken over by damn drunk blokes. But unfortunately, the Good, the Great, and the Legonex is still on hiatus, and everyone's lazy and doesn't do nothing. Apart from
DDB Comics guy.
He's here with me today, and we've got Dickface, Chaz's younger brother.
Oh, yay!
Now, we are the only three people that have seen this film. We are the only three out of the group that have seen it and loved it. There are other people that have seen it, but they haven't bothered turning up today. We are going to start off with just saying how fucking brilliant it is.
Yeah,
it was.
And how it's better than all the Avengers bullshit.
Right up.
And well worth going to watch. So we'll go into just a generalisation. It's a great, what is it, a revenge story? A time-travelling revenge story or a team-up story?
Oh. You said it's a family story.
Well, yeah, it's about family. Yeah. It's about family. So it's a family story. First one was a love story. This is a family story. We're going to do no spoilers at this moment, but what did you think? Quick non-spoiler review.
I mean, yeah, like it was completely packed with like crazy madness and constant jokes from the start. I had a smile on my face throughout the whole film. Even the sad parts, I was still smiling. So I love a bit of fucking torment and despair. And it was, you know, like Deadpool himself getting to grips with losing
his... Yeah, no spoilers.
With losing it, like his way of being yeah, like...
Anyway, I'd agree with that. I think like the first one did suffer sort of midway through with a bit of lag. Like there was a bit where the joke sort of ended and it was a bit too serious. This one is non-stop fucking Deadpoolness. Boom, boom, boom. Yeah. I reckon this has got more rewatchability than the other one.
And as a comic book fan, it pays more attention to the comics than put myself out on the limit than most of the MCU films.
The thing is, with Deadpool, obviously, and the sporadicness of like how the episodes are written anyway, it can get away with so much sort of incorporated, and it has that dynamic that is Deadpool. It is like reading something out of one of the books.
It's definitely a family film as well. Like a strong part of the film is family. It's like even Deadpool himself is coming to terms with what family is.
And trying
to sort of like, you know, find where he fits in that dynamic of a family. And then you've got Cable and himself, like his story starts from
about his family.
So we're
going to carry on to a little bit more of this. So people that don't want to know any spoilers or anything else or haven't seen the film yet, stop listening now, jump forward 20 minutes and we'll get back to the other shit that we normally do. But for the next 20 minutes, it's going to be spoiler filled.
Spoilers everywhere.
Like, and that starts now. Fucking Juggernaut!
Boom!
Oh my! When it was like, oh, the biggest guy in the place, and I was like, boom! Who could that be? I was like, oh, I don't know. And then the shot where what's his name? Fucking Fire Fist. The shot where Fire Fist is outside the door, and it's like you can see it from Juggernaut's perspective, like over his shoulder, and he's fucking huge. I'm like, who the fuck is this guy?
I knew it straight away. No. You must have clocked it.
And then he came out, he's a fucking unit. Like, yes,
beautiful. I had that double doubt moment. You're like, it's Juggernaut.
It must be. No, it's not.
There's no way they're going to say Juggernaut. And they followed the
animated series version where he's Xavier's brother.
I wear the helmet so
my brother can't get into my head. They even mentioned that. Yeah. And the fight between him and Colossus is straight out of the 90s cartoon. Yeah. It's like shot for shot the same. Yeah. One time the bus gets picked up and whacked in. That happens in the cartoon.
Oh, man, that's like a comics fan. Like, you've got Black Tom Cassidy.
Yeah.
You've got the... The school where he goes is the Essex school. Yeah. Nathaniel Essex is
I said that straight away. Yeah. It's like, how's that? That was weird.
I noticed that too.
And there's like, even silly nods. At the end of the fight, Deadpool's costume is grey and black. That's his X-Force suit.
Beautiful little touch, man.
Look, at the end of it as well, when he's like, obviously, been blown apart and he's got it all duct taped together.
It's the same thing. I ran the waistband when he tore it off.
And this is a major comic spoiler for it. He says his daughter's name at the end is Rachel.
Yeah.
Rachel Summers is in the X-Men at the minute.
Shit, yeah.
Carrying on the kind of...
Oh, fuck, They don't even mention that he's Cyclops' kid, in it? Cable is, but like...
Yeah.
And the bit where the actual X-Men are behind him. The cameo from all the current X-Men.
It's only you lot in here.
I need to get something over the Good, the Great, and the Logan X other two didn't turn up. So this proves what timeline this is in, because you can't have Cable without Cyclops, so yeah. It has to be the new timeline.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So thank God for Days of Future Past.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So, well, then there was Apocalypse. Anyway, that's not the point. Right, yeah. So the point is how fucking awesome this film was. Joke after joke. And the other thing I was impressed with was the fact that all them jokes that are in the adverts, they're all different in the fucking film.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
yeah.
I want to go and see a film, another screening of the film, just in case they're different again.
Yeah.
Because I know
yeah,
that
man.
He had like 20 odd like one-liners.
That's like one thing I loved about the first film, the first Deadpool film. It was like, it was... There was just so many jokes, and like they let Ryan Reynolds just like go
ad lib it.
Completely. So much of it, and it was just like for so many of the scenes, he had so many different fucking takes and so many different little jokes that they just let him go off the bat on, and it was like you had the adverts, you had the trailers. And I'm like, I hate watching trailers.
Yeah.
If it's a film I know I'm going to want to watch, I'm going to go and see. I don't like watching the trailers in case it spoils it. I accidentally saw too many that I wanted to see, and none of those jokes came up.
Yeah. None of them had the same setup and a different fucking ending.
I loved
like, man.
I love that she made Weasel like Weasel in the comics. Yeah. That tickled me when he's like,
when he's kidnapped. Yeah, that was like, exactly him.
He's like, no, you don't need to do that.
Tell you nothing. All right, I'll tell you a thing.
Yeah. That's it. I'm not telling you anything else. Oh yeah, by the way, watch out for the wind.
Yeah, it's absolutely brilliant. And then. The opening credits, man, the Celine Dion song, and like the Bond-esque choreography done by Blind Al, and stuff like that.
I was laughing my head off.
I was in the cinema. There was a couple of other proper fans there, and like people that were fans of the film, and like they're not laughing. And when it came up choreography by Blind Al, no one paid attention. I was in hysterics.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. It's like it's a laugh a minute, but it's hard as those really sincere moments. Like I said with me, the part with Cable, like where he actually
it goes back to the spoiler.
You feel it more. I feel like you feel it more.
Yeah.
Like when
the bit where he's actually dying, when he's actually dying, he won't die, and he just keeps going. And then another thing, and then another thing, and I'm like, is he hurt?
It was hilarious, but at the same time, it's like it still kind of touches you.
Yeah,
and like more than other Marvel films, it's like it feels more.
One quote I want to use is that obviously only besties kill paedophiles together. What a line!
Yeah.
Only besties shoot paedophiles together. So much stuff, so many jokes, so fucking awesome.
Like that headmaster with like the flame.
Yeah.
I can't remember the character's name, but he's like quintessential Claremont era kind of like mutant hate creature to the tail.
The bit when Firefist first shows up and he's killing all the people, they've got the, what are they called? They're in all the X-Men shit. The mutant, the Department of Mutant, fucking, the army-based people that just go after mutants. It's like the beginning of the Sentinel, basically.
Yeah.
They're there.
Yeah.
And they're arguing with them to get this kid. And it's like, fuck,
Yeah,
you don't know. Many nods to so many things that you've seen before, and like they all happen so fast that you can't pull them all out into like one order. And it's like this sets up, like if they do it well, this sets up X-Men films for the next fucking 10 years.
Yeah, it's great. They've
got a new young cast for them as well. So obviously
the joke about we've got to put a team together. Let's make sure that they're young so that we can get 10 years worth of franchise out of them.
Yeah,
I mean fucking hell.
That's exactly what they've done.
And the bit was like, who the fuck are you? I'm Batman. He cross pollinated broke the fifth wall.
Yeah.
Like, he understands he's in the comics. He understands
the 16th wall, man. It's like a wall.
That's not even my
famous film
joke.
Yeah,
and this is such a small one, and I noticed it in the trailer where he's got baby legs.
Yeah.
I was sitting there. I saw it in the trailer, and I checked. I was like, it's Flipping Chunk from the Goonies shirt. And Josh Brolin's first film was The Goonies.
Oh shit! Oh,
I was sitting there, I was like, I've got to check this out. So there's a Goonies reference in Deadpool.
There's a couple. Because it's having a big fight.
It's something that you straight up
like
say
you,
soon. Yeah.
What,
that's beautiful.
No, it's like you're trying to bully your older brother to find some treasure or something. Yeah, like while he's getting beaten the fuck out.
Yeah.
And it's when the tunnel explodes, when they're going to get away. He goes, bet there's no pirate treasure at the end of this tunnel.
I watched Goonies the next day after that as well. I was like, yes,
It doesn't age well, does it, the Goonies?
Oh, man, of course it fucking does.
Shh, we're talking about Deadpool.
ice related.
Well, apparently it is now because that show.
Yeah. It was so good though. Like blind, like all the characters, like where they. I said the problem was, like, I would have been happy if, like, they completely ignored the first film yeah. and just made a new film with loads yeah. of new characters in yeah. it, because that's what Deadpool comics are. They're, like, short-run, yeah. big stories, and then they start again. But he's, like the character continuing of this one has just opened up. The time travel at the end credit scene's fucking, yeah. like,
fucking epic.
Fucking amazing.
Yeah, it's perfect. It's like, oh, shit, what have
There's
we done?
There's been a Twitter conversation between Ryan Reynolds and Josh Brolin
yeah.
about how stupid the end credit scenes are. Because like we haven't even got a reason to go back in time because you went back and saved your girlfriend, dickhead. None of that would have happened.
He's going to go back for fun, though, surely.
Well, apparently there's one, there's a deleted scene where he goes back and kills Hitler.
Yeah. As a
but as a baby. And he went, maybe that's a bit strong to put in a film, shooting a baby in the face.
I'll tell you what, I'd have set up the next X-Men film easily. Because so there's so many holes in flipping time travel now that you can literally yeah. walk between them.
Yeah. And it's just like, it's mind blowing.
Deadpool was there involved as well. We can just
and it's mind blowing how much money it's done and everything else. Top grossing R-rated movie by double of the last one. Opening weekend was like, I think the opening weekend was something like $175 million.
That was just US.
That was just US, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I think
yeah,
worldwide. Yeah, worldwide, it's like pretty much on par with Infinity War.
Yeah.
And it's like, what the fuck, man? That's 10 years in the making. Well, to be fair, he's been trying to get that made since 2012, like yeah, the original yeah, one. So yeah. it's like, but it just proves that my favourite character is just fucking better than everyone. Yeah, I love being right.
Every Deadpool, every film that Deadpool's in is always going to do well.
Well, not it's really. Always it's more Wolverine well. Origins. Like, and they
it's always
going
to do well. No, I mean,
I'm just here to fix the timeline.
Yeah, but like,
yeah, that was fucking beautiful. That was fucking beautiful, man.
Oh.
Hugh Jackman standing there like,
fucking
because yeah. like, Wade, is that you? Hi. Boom, in the head. And then it's the repeating shots. One, two, yeah. three. One, two, three, four.
I love
one, two, three, four, five, six, seven.
I love that he came for a back podcast there. Recently. That's quite actually nice to say after yeah. you've watched Wolverine Origins. Yeah.
Like Hugh Jackman was like, oh, that's my last, Logan's my last film.
Yeah, he's tempting him, ain't he?
He came back for that little, of course he wants to come back. Of course he wants to do
well,
more.
He said the word recently, didn't he?
Of course he does.
With so much time travel, like
Stan
just
said. One fucking line.
But as Stan just said, like so many time travel possibilities now that, yeah, they can do a film no matter what. Fit in between Wolverine and Logan.
Yeah.
They could do whatever the fuck they wanted. It could be a different timeline completely.
They could do a film, have it filled with fucking madness and fun and excitement and hilarious fucking madness, but like, and then at the end just be like, oh, that never happened. And it could still be fucking beautiful.
I want
like, in that setting.
What they set up in this film. I want Mr. Sinister as a villain in
They set it up
because you'd
film,
have the ultimate straight man against the ultimate flipping comedy guy.
Yeah. I would love to see
that.
They
set up Essex Court in Days of Future Apocalypse.
Apocalypse.
They set that up then.
Yeah.
So, and then like I was expecting a Sinister X-Men film, and basically what they set up was a Deadpool film.
Yeah, but they
well,
gave
they
you, they gave
out
you
and
Cable.
Mutants.
They gave you Cable, right?
Yeah.
They gave you Cable, and Mr. Sinister makes a.
He's trying to
copy
of
everyone, Gene, right?
Yeah.
And then their copy of Gene sucks Cyclops. And then
I wonder if it were Mr. Sinister. I wouldn't be surprised if they was going to put him in New Mutants, and then they took that idea out. Mm-hmm. But he's Mr. Sinister is very much tied into Gambit's origin, so I'm wondering if they're
that'll
hoping
be
that
the
for a film.
We need a good bit of Gambit. Man,
also,
like
the X-Force
the little
thing
taste of
you
Gambit
thought,
we have.
Like all them things we speculated beforehand. All the X-Force. Oh, he's going to be in it. He's going to be in it. He's going to be in it. They fucking wipe him out in five minutes. There's none left.
Yeah. Right to the fucking X-Force.
Yeah.
All done by. Oh, he gets fucking sad.
Star Shatter,
fucking Tangerine
gets
my
boss. The Invisible
Did you know
one?
That Matt Damon was the hillbilly?
Yes.
Cable comes back, that's Alan Tudyk and Matt Damon
talking
about wiping
toilet
your ass.
Shit, man.
Yeah.
And like, what's in the Vanisher was fucking Brad Pitt. Like, it's literally 2 seconds. His face is in the film for 2 seconds. Like, yes.
Well, they said, like, Ryan Reynolds, he wrote him a letter, and the deal was that he got basic payment, and he had to make him a cappuccino. It took longer for Brad Pitt to drink the cappuccino.
Then he was in a film. Yeah.
Brilliant. Fucking amazing.
Yeah, I mean, it was like, it was worth it.
Oh man, he's facing
I
mean,
I was holding out for it. As I said, don't go to the cinema that lot. Like, the choice was there, Infinity War or fucking Deadpool, and I'm so glad I picked that way.
Yeah.
I mean, Deadpool, like, Infinity War has been spoiled to me over the internet and things at large. But Deadpool, my God, was I so happy to be there. Like, the fact, you thought Cable was going to be the bad guy, you weren't sure what's going to happen afterwards. The fact that...
They walked a wonderful line with Cable, like, it's...
If you haven't seen Infinity War and you haven't seen Deadpool 2, see Infinity Wars first, because Deadpool 2 will like give you that cherry on top of the fucking cake, man. Like, see him in the right fucking order.
Yeah, man, definitely. I think we should wrap this up now. We're going to stick this into a bigger episode. We've obviously been to Comic-Con today, so you've probably heard us talk before this, but I mean, final thoughts. Where do you think they're going to go next?
I'm doubling down on the Mr. Sinister angle, and then X-Force first.
I wouldn't like to make a guess. I'm just fully excited to see what's going to happen. It's like Deadpool's just been given the ability to time travel.
Yeah, that man.
Who fucking knows what he's going to do with that? He's probably going to fuck around with. He's going to fuck around with Wolverine.
Hey, it was Cable for me. Josh Brolin walked such a fine line, because it's not like with the funny characters, the mistake they always make is like, oh, I'm not going to be funny, and he's like, no, I just don't get your humour. He doesn't even try to.
It was funny. Yeah,
that's
makes
it good. He's the best straight man.
The film's beat up. The film's build up into that state, and then he's still acting in the state of like.
Yeah,
the rest of the Marvel films, basically. It's like serious, and they
MCU. They actually had someone who walked the line between antagonists and protagonists.
Yeah.
And you felt for him, like, when he decided to save...
Big time, big time.
Yeah, he decides to save Deadpool rather than...
The whole way through the film, I feel like Cable's doing the right thing how he sees it.
Yeah.
And then it's like, oh, shit, like, he's come around. And at the point where he's like...
When he shows up with Blind Owl's there.
No.
And he's talking to him, like, Ryan Reynolds sitting there with his baby legs, and he's like, blah, 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 and he's right behind you now. And they just go, what? And
It's like taking a fucking piss out of, like, he's right behind
me.
Right?
Yeah, he's right behind you, even though I can see him, I'm telling you.
One thing I want to say about Cable is, like, the whole film is, like, you expect him to be a certain way, you expect him to be a certain kind of guy, and then he passes up the chance for him to go home,
but like, it was always a one-way trip.
The teddy's unburnt, and Deadpool notices that, and it's like a nice little moment where he's like, he's real with him, and he's like shit, look.
Yeah, but that's what I just said. Only besties shoot pedophiles together.
Yeah, like seriously, they got a fucking really nice tight bond, and then he passes up that opportunity to go home with his wife and kid to be like, nah. Like, you guys need me.
Yeah.
He's like,
I'm going to stay here and make sure you don't fuck up this one.
Yeah. But really, he's found something. Like, he feels like
family.
He fits.
That's
it.
It's family, man. Family. Yeah.
And even though he's got a wife and kid, like, this family is just found.
But
found
in his now, time, it was like, in his time, man, then that family's beautiful. Dead. So if he goes back, surely that would have never happened, so he wouldn't fit in that time.
Well, there's a whole conspiracy
about Deadpool and why he wants him to be alive.
But this is the other thing. Sorry. Do you remember the original Deadpool? He had the teleporter.
Yeah.
Teleported all over the place. Right? When I saw Negasonic
Teenage Warhead.
There we go.
Fixing with that thing, I was like, is Deadpool about to get his teleporter? I didn't think it was going to be the time travel. I was like, is Deadpool going to be like old school Deadpool? He's like end of 90s. No, he's like early 2000s Deadpool. Is he going to go back to old 90s Deadpool? He's just bouncing all over the place.
They've just done the smart thing. They just nicked a bit of everything. That's what you need.
It was just like, as soon as they done it, I was like, oh shit, what have we done? That means you're in store for fucking madness. The guy's going to go all over the fucking place, taking a piss out of everyone he can. We're going to see little hints on all the old movies, him taking a fucking absolute piss out of them. Like, I think, oh man, it's going to be fun. You know that for 100% for a fact, it's going to be fucking fun.
Mm. Right.
Deadpool's going to be passing through time.
Let's hope so. Let's hope Ryan Reynolds gets on the bike and like carries on with it.
Mm.
Let's hope that there's more of this to come.
He's not dropping that. He's not dropping that.
I've said there's going to be.
The thing, he didn't even want to think about Deadpool 3. He's got an idea, but he didn't even want to think about it. He was so Deadpooled out. The amount of promotion he did for it just knackered him out as it was. He went on that Korean Korean karaoke show as a unicorn.
With that kind of hero, with that kind of like.
Well, he's not a hero. Deadpool's not
a hero. No, he is, though.
That's the point. Don't call him a hero.
He's an anti-hero.
He's not an anti-hero, because that would be opposite of a hero.
He's someone doing the right thing. He exists.
Okay.
He's doing the right thing for normally unusual purposes.
He comes from a good place. All right, as far as the films tell me, the guy's a fucking hero. He always, like, he takes a piss out of everyone. As soon as the right thing comes up that no one else sees, that no one else jumps on, he jumps on it. And he tries to do the right fucking thing. The guy's a hero.
So, like, if you read Mr. Bunn, who luckily we had an interview with earlier, which you'll hear just after this, is he wrote down, like, Deadpool killed everyone in the Marvel Universe.
Mm-hmm.
Then Deadpool killed everybody in history that contributed to the heroes of today. So like Sherlock Holmes, Beowulf.
He did.
He's done it. It's already happened.
Sherlock and Beowulf. Yeah, and fucking hilarious.
And then the only people left in the multiverse were other Deadpools. So he killed all the Deadpools, and then walked away going, "Huh, maybe I'm the center of the multiverse." And he is, because he's got no limitations and no anything else. And I mean, that's what these films are like.
He's beyond it. He's beyond everything else.
That's the point.
He's like, in our universe.
During the time when he was up against Thanos, or working with Thanos, sort of vice versa, he knocks out Eternity. He gets super powered up and knocks out Eternity, one of the creators of the multiverse. He just floors him. Well, I've done. And that's Deadpool. Anyway, we're going to wrap this up now. Any final words?
I'm gutted that Death wasn't in the film.
This is the thing. What if that bird is Death?
Yes, I also
thought that. What if that bird is Death?
That would be epic. Like, but I just really hope that the next Deadpool film, the next film that Deadpool's in, I would very much enjoy him to meet Death.
I wonder if the bird is. Like, but anyway.
Or if she slowly turned into
Just give me Mr. Sinister and give me Wolverine in the next film.
That'd be amazing. What an amazing team up. My theories of it are, fuck me, Deadpool's great. Deadpool's always going to be great. Deadpool's been great since the first Deadpool comic I picked up. I live in a time now when I go, oh yeah, you ever heard of Deadpool? And people go, yeah! Like, that never used to happen. Never used to happen.
Yeah.
I feel like a messiah.
So we're going to wrap this interview up, like this talk now. We're going to carry on with our expo stuff. And say goodbye, everyone.
Nice one, guys. Speak to you in a bit.
Bye.
See ya.
Okay, so it's me, Shogun Pumba, here at MCM Comic Con for Dem Drunk Blokes podcast. I'm here with Lefty No Hands. He's recording for us.
Hey, hey, hey.
And I'm with, you've heard me wax lyrical about him before, my greatest writing hero, Mr. Cullen Bunn. Say hello, sir.
Hey, guys. How are you?
Awesome. Yeah, cheers, man. Cheers for having a couple of minutes and taking out your time on a busy day.
Oh, I'm happy to do it.
So first of all, like, how are you enjoying the con? I mean, how many times have you been to London? What are you thinking?
So this is my first time to London. It's my first UK con. It's been a lot of fun. I've had a great time. It's been very busy. I don't think I've seen much of the convention, so I'm thinking here in a little bit. After we're done chatting, I'm going to go walk around the convention a little bit.
There's some nice things to go and look at. I mean, what would be your interest in looking around?
You know, I'm still a comic book collector, so I have a want list, mostly old X-Men comics that I'm trying to gather up. So
there's a stall in the other hall. He's got graded comics, X-Men for X-Force.
Awesome.
Loads of them. So worth having a look in that side. Talking to X-Men, obviously you write for X-Men. I mean, obviously everyone's heard me talk about the Kill Island Duke, Deadpool being my fave. You've wrote some of the greatest Deadpool stories that have ever been written. I mean, Night of the Living Deadpool, Killology.
You remember them about as well as I do,
What is it like, obviously, working with such great characters? And obviously, what I know what you bring to it, but what would you say your writing style is?
It's fun because, you know, like I said, I've been a comic collector and a comic reader since I was a kid. So these are the characters that I grew up loving. So, I mean, maybe not Deadpool. He wasn't around. I was a little older when he came around. But
this was perfect for being a bit older, no?
Yeah, but, I love these characters. I've always loved them. It's exciting for me to feel like I'm contributing to the mythology of the world and to the shared universe. So that's fun. I think every writer brings something different. I don't know what it is that I don't know if I could quantify what I bring to it. I think every writer brings something a little different. My goal when I first started writing for these characters is like, I just want to make fun comics that everyone can enjoy. And then of course I wrote Deadpool Kills the Marvel Universe, where it might be fun, but it's fun in a sort of sick and disturbing way.
Well, I mean, sick and disturbing. You did Minimum Carnage as well, and Venomized.
Yes.
You did a few of those. I mean, and also sick and disturbing. I don't know too much about it, but Harrow County. Tell us a bit more about that.
Yeah. So Harrow County is it's a creator-owned book I do for Dark Horse. It's a horror book. So, you know, I do a lot of books that are lean towards dark fantasy and horror. Harrow County is more, I describe it more as sort of a dark fairy tale. It's a horror book that people who don't like horror books could read, or I've also described it as the sweetest horror story you'll ever read. It's about a young woman who discovers on the eve of her 18th birthday that she may be the reincarnation of an infamous witch that has lived out in the woods years ago. And that kind of turns her life upside down. But it's her approach to this realization and this new paradigm that kind of makes her a different kind of character. Just as an example, she goes out in the woods and she finds a boy's flayed skin hanging in briar patch. And the skin is sort of twitching and talking.
So not too dark.
So at that point it sounds pretty horrifying. The skin is sort of twitching and talking to her. And as you might do, she gathers it up, puts it in a bag, and carries it around as her friend, and it becomes like her little buddy throughout the story.
That does sound like some of our D&D campaigns.
Yeah, pretty much.
Animated corpse, animated corpse that they're just carrying around as a pal.
Yeah.
Have you guys heard of Metro? I'm gonna give you one of these. So this is a book I've got coming out. Have you ever heard of the show Impractical Jokers?
Yeah.
So Brian Quinn from Impractical Jokers and I are co-writing this book.
Oh, no way.
And it's being illustrated by Walt Flanagan.
Yeah, okay.
So I think podcasters, you guys will probably know those guys, right? So this is a book we've been working on for a while now, and it's going to be coming out. We're going to kickstart it. Kickstart the book as a big trade paperback.
Yeah.
So I'll give you a couple of these. This is just a preview edition we did.
Yeah.
But we're excited.
If we give one of these away as a...
Yeah, because I know Quinn's like a big comic book.
Oh, yeah.
I follow him on Instagram and all that anyway. Tell him Steve Dave.
I met him because when I did the Lobo book a few years ago, and it was such a different Lobo than what people were used to.
Yeah.
And he was giving me trouble about Lobo. I met him on Twitter. He was like giving me trouble about that version of Lobo.
And
how it's not as good as the main man. I was like, well, I'm not necessarily disagreeing with you, but I have to write what they tell, that's the character they want right now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, but he loves comics. So this has been something he's been cooking up for a while. The original idea is something he's had in his head for a while, and then we got together and kind of fleshed it out and made it into a book. And it's done. I mean, it's more than five issues worth of comics. So it'll be a big, thick trade when it comes out.
Okay, so that's going to be a Kickstarter.
Yeah, we decided the way for us to do it was to kickstart it, and then eventually it'll be available to retailers as well. But we're going to kickstart it initially, like a trade and a nice hardcover limited edition that'll be on the Kickstarter too.
Excellent.
And like I said, we're probably going to announce it. This may be the official announcement, I guess, what I'm giving you guys.
I'll tell you what, if that's the official, then that's awesome.
We're going to probably start putting tweets and stuff out about it, just saying it's coming here in the next week or two. You'll start seeing it.
And then we'll go live with it.
Well, you'll have us retweeting it left, right,
center. Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Oh, well, cheers for that again, dude. Have a great day and enjoy the con, man. Enjoy it.
Yourselves.
Awesome, thank you.
So, there was like Mars Attacks people.
Do you want to do that after I plop us back in?
Well, that just doesn't help me anything, does it, really?
Oh, we need to clap back in first.
That's
a leg.
I know what.
Knees and shins.
Yeah.
I'll hold it.
Lee has calves.
Do you know what I thought about? You know the.
We'll clap back in.
You know who was the president in Mars Attack?
Donald Trump. Oh,
quick!
Was it Jack Nicholson?
Yeah.
Did he get his fingers bit off? Yeah. No, the president's secretary, Michael J. Fox.
Yes. What?
Who's Pierce Brosnan?
Michael J. Fox gets his fingers bitten off.
The President's Secretary in Mars Attacks was Michael J. Fox. I need to see this.
Hurry up!
Michael J. Fox is the shaky bastard.
Yeah, anyway, let us clap us back in. Very, yeah, very convincing.
You gotta help me, Doc. Very convincing words.
That's right, I'll find out.
Hang on! Jesus, this is like the longest.
I wasn't even trying to convince anyone. I was asking a question.
Whenever you ask a question, I see it as a statement.
Guys, let's get back into it. This is a So that was Cullen Bunn, my hero. If you want to go and find his stuff, I mean, it's fucking everywhere. I mean,
speak to me at D3G Comics. I can hunt quite a bit of it down and have quite a bit.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's quite a bit in stock for me. Yes. But yeah.
It's not who I said it was.
Okay, so yes, I was about to say Michael J. Fox, you cunt. So go to at D3G Comics on Twitter, or go to at the DDB Comics guy.
Yeah.
Also D3G on Facebook.
Yeah.
Go there, ask Dan about it, and he'll get you all of the greatest, like the trade paperbacks. Get the Killology and the trade paperback. Yeah. I've got a set signed today. One thing that might not be in that interview is he's working with the guy from Impractical Jokers.
Yeah, Brian Quinn.
Michael J. Fox is in Mars Attacks.
Hang on, sorry. he's working with Quinn from Impractical Jokers.
Yeah,
and
Brian Quinn.
It's going to be illustrated by Walter Flanagan.
Yeah.
Ooh.
And it's called Metro.
Yeah.
And we have a preview copy signed by Cullen Bunn himself to give away on the show. So, at the end of this show, we've got a load of loot. We're going to give you some random questions. You tweeted the answers to us, and we will send you the loot that we made. But that is one that's a bit of a prized possession.
Yeah, big time.
One needs to have a look at that before it goes.
Yeah, so the premises of that, anyway, is basically that Brian Q kind of went to Bun about it and had this idea about...
Well, he had an argument with Bun on Twitter over the Lobo issue that Bun wrote.
Yes.
He said that the Lobo wasn't Lobo as he liked it. They had a massive argument, and he went, do you want to come write my story? And yeah, that might be an interview. It depends on how we can cut it, because there was a lot of waffle in between some bits. But yeah, we will give that away. Go look that out. That'll be kickstarted in a 5-volume TP, so a fucking massive trade paperback. Mm. It'll be kickstarted sometime soon. This might actually be the first press release about it. Because although he was telling people at the con, he doesn't think he's told anyone in the media. So this could be an exclusive.
Yeah, pretty much.
Nice.
And we got it signed. So yeah, the booty bag.
Yeah. Well, Walt Flanagan's. Yeah, Quinn's writing it. With Bun and Walt Flanagan's illustrating it.
Surely it depends on how fast this podcast gets out.
Yeah. Well,
end of the day, hopefully.
Walt Flanagan's friends with Kevin Smith, ain't
That's it, right.
And he's done the Secret Batman, Stash, the Widening Guy.
The Daredevil things, he was working on them. And he also did Cryptozoic Man, was his own comic.
Yeah.
You heard it here first, guys, or second or third, depending on when you tune in.
Thanks for that update. Right, so rest of the con today. What happened, guys? We queued up with the promise of cocaine and strippers to a big bus.
That's right. Yeah, we ended up going into a Republic of Gamers. great big kind of
bus, double-decker bus. Promised cocaine and hookers. We queued up for a little while, and who showed up?
Me, dick face.
Yeah. Oy, oy. As if you had sat nav on, he just showed up while we were in the queue. What are you queuing for?
Radar. Human radar. I turned up. I saw the backside of this bus, and I was like, they're on the other side of this fucking bus. Walked around the other side. There they were in this queue, quotation marks. And I walked around to the outside of the queue, and they welcomed me in.
So I got in the queue. So yeah, we
there
ended
I was.
Up going
no
upstairs.
One fucking knew. They've been there for like about 10-15 minutes.
Yeah, run out of alcohol.
Standing there drinking.
Yeah.
Blah blah blah. The promise of cocaine and fucking naked women.
And what happened?
I was ecstatic. My first fucking moments of being there. I've been there like fucking 40 seconds. I just got my wristband. I just got in. I'm promised cocaine and naked women. We get in there.
And it was laptops.
We're taken to the top deck of the fucking bus. What do I see? Fucking monitor screens, keyboards, and fucking mice.
And he was like, at least I can get some decent porn.
And no!
Yes!
No! You weren't even allowed to go!
I wasn't even allowed to go on the browser.
We played Counter-Strike Go. on the laggiest fucking LAN party. Awful. I'm not sure how that worked.
But it wasn't lag. There was special. Like,
special abilities.
It was a special attention. DLC.
You weren't paying attention. Basically, right? This was like the best kind of version of the game. Right?
We had superpowers.
Yeah, you got the kind of superpowers that any kind of beautiful person would actually want. Teleportation, never dying, and never actually killing anyone.
Yeah.
But sometimes killing people without knowing.
No, but only at the end.
And also, not forgetting the inability to know what the fuck you're doing every moment of your life.
Yeah.
That was probably the most prominent power.
Internet for the first time and being put Halo in front of everyone, like a dial-up internet connection.
Yeah, at the age of 7 or 8.
Yeah. Well,
do you know what, actually? Because what seemed really out of place is in the background, when we had those headphones on, I wasn't hearing
the AOL dial-up. Right, but we did have one of the longest videos of the day is just us shouting, like any true gaming experience is us shouting, lag! Lag! Lag, you can't die!
It's lag!
It's so much lag! What's this? Like, and he did, thinking
lag
about it,
lag.
He promised us the ultimate gaming experience. It's pretty much what you experience at our
The hilarious plan, thing was that it's all LAN, so we're all actually just connected to each other and then bots. So it's like there's four people on this side, which was us four people in the other team, which was some other people, and then like another four on our team and another four on their team,
bots,
which were all bots. The bots were lagging. Everything was lagging. It didn't make any fucking sense.
No sense whatsoever.
And the bots got like 57 kills apiece, and our team won.
The bots weren't lagging.
When we saw them,
they were lagging. Oh, fuck it.
I don't understand how we were lagging, even though it was all into like
a land
bus.
Party.
You'd stop in a bus.
You'd stop moving. You stop moving, like hands off the fucking controls, and you get spun around, thrown down a street, thrown down a fucking silo.
And kill someone, and then be
killed.
Yeah. But it's like at one point, we both stopped and looked at the monitor, and our hands were doing all
Like switching between weapons and that.
For an audio. Yeah, I know. It's great,
and even though we had absolutely
I recorded
no
it on video, though, so yeah, that's actually that would be out.
Even though we had absolutely no fucking control over what we were doing, at any moment in time, we still fucking won,
and we sorry about your ears. We got a Gaming Republic.
Fuck your ears.
If you leave your address in the comments below, we can find your address and fuck you in the ears.
Yeah, and a mouse mat.
Right, you finished.
Yes.
So we got three drawstring bags.
Yes, I've
so
got
we'll,
one.
Question: first three people to answer correctly, we'll send you a drawstring bag. Okay, that's all I want to say. Because we won, we got a drawstring Game of Republic of Gamers bag.
What's the question? We don't know yet.
We'll make them up later.
Sounds like signing out of Star Wars. Who's more foolish, the fool or the fool follows them? You got told strippers and hookers, and then you get in there and still sat down and played the game.
The fool who follows them. Sorry, I didn't mean to answer your question before you finish your sentence.
But yeah, you know us, right, Dan? We are definitely, no matter if we're following no one or nothing, we're the biggest fools in any venue.
That's all I could get in mind. It's like, if that was me, I would walk in there with no hookers, right? So yeah. I'm going home.
But Dan, you got to realise that was just to get in the queue. Yeah. We was already in the queue. So what was ever at the end of the queue, we was doing it anyway. And we had already, even when we was at the arse end of the queue, we joined a queue.
Believe us, we are British, so we get in the queue.
We're going to get in the queue, no matter what.
Yeah. We weren't following anyone. We just enjoyed a little story that a fat guy told us at the entrance.
We knew it was false. We knew it was false. We knew the story was filled with lies.
You weren't even there!
I was there just before the moment of finding out that it was all lies. You told me the guy who told you to
come around the back of the XL with him. I'll give you an experience.
And I can tell you one thing.
And it weren't VR.
I can tell you a DDB first. That guy weren't lying.
And what was he dressed up as?
Winnie the Pooh, right?
Whatever I want him
to do. You do it at the conclusion, just go, oh, oh bother.
Alright, so that happened. Then we walked around a bit more. We took loads and loads of pictures. We played a bit of frisbee, went to the off license, sat in a park miles away from the convention.
It wasn't miles away from the convention.
Fucking miles away.
Oh man, it took forever.
Exactly.
It was not forever.
It was a very nice park.
We got a picture of BJ Wines though, which was all worth it.
Mm-hmm. I actually got a tan on Friday.
Do you know what?
From being inside, to being inside.
You went to MCM. Fucking Comic Con at the XL Centre.
And got a tan.
Which is completely enclosed.
Yeah.
And you got a tan.
Oh, mate, you should say I'm donning it.
So, what most people get from MCM is normally a clutcher where they dehydrate. That's the most common thing.
Oh, so we tried some energy drinks as well.
Oh, yeah, we tried some energy powder. We got a video of that. Powder drinks. Look, they,
Two videos!
Comes in a tub like
one done on Friday.
Comes in a tub like pre workout and protein powder.
Have you ever had pre workout?
Yeah.
Oh my god, that shit's fine.
That's shush. I'll talk about other.
Sorry.
But yeah, it comes in a tub like that.
Yeah.
And you scoop it in and it's a flat energy drink. But it's like, we worked out if you add purple, whatever the flavour of purple was, with apple juice and vodka.
Sorry, Dad.
Yes.
Oh god, I missed out.
I thought he was a scoutmaster again.
hang on.
Now, what you guys didn't see just then was DDB's voice guy.
Reached between DDB Comics guy's legs. Pulled out something cold and long.
It's just like Scouts.
And he's about to supple on that.
Oh, it's just like Scouts all over again.
Right. Let's finish this up because we've gone long enough.
Well, no, we've only done...
About four days.
Yeah, we cut this.
No, I don't want to cut it. That's the fucking point.
Oh, it's all been gold.
Oh, no.
It's all been gold. There's
what
no
about the silver bits?
You wait till when me and Pumba cut this, it's going to be 6.5 minutes long.
There hasn't been any gold. It's all been at least silver.
Oh, Pumba's not happy.
Pumba's confused. It's not hard. What did we rent a park, went back to play some frisbee. That's what we did.
And that was fun.
Yep. And then went walked round and had a free burger.
Got a free burger for hashtagging a burger stall.
Did we?
You were there.
There is a website on the internet. It is called Twitter.
And you can see the picture. Go and get yourself a burger.
What is that?
If you sign up to Twitter... And you put your name in and you have some fucking comments and then you can fucking post a picture of you, not a selfie, as they call it, up against a poster in that place that we're talking about right now. And you...
Other places are available.
Get a free fucking burger.
Yeah, Batman or Superman.
Once you provide them provide them the information... of you posting yourself on Twitter.
But unfortunately, guys, the event's all over now, so...
No burgers.
Yeah, fuck. Enjoy the rest of your night. Cry away. Fuck
you.
We've
still got more to talk about at the con, man.
Yeah, but I just want to let them know that they fucking missed that. And it's their own fault.
Yeah, because if you were there and didn't come and meet us and buy us a beer, we're very disappointed in you and stop listening right now.
And you didn't. And you didn't. So if you're one of those people...
We love you.
Dick face enough.
That's true, yeah, sorry.
So, rest of the con.
Right, so we've got our pictures taken in a booth.
In a booth, yeah. We've got a couple of them, we've got to sign them. Me, Lefty No Hands, and the voice guy. got a Crunchyroll Japanese version of, pictures taken.
Yep.
You know, like all comedy pictures. We did all comedy pictures. It was fun.
There's no such thing as comedy pictures.
We'll sign them.
Yeah.
We shall sign them and give them away as a prize as well.
And I'm sure you'll all be happy to know that I
wasn't there. And then, what else happened?
Well, the fantastic cosplayers, first off. I want to start talking about that. The variety of fucking things.
You got a piggyback off Deadpool.
I did get a piggyback off Deadpool, yeah. Right through the main stage when they were doing something kind of weird.
The outdoor courtyard stage, he ran all the way through.
Not me, personally, Deadpool did.
He was whipping his ass.
Piggyback. I just thought, I'm on. Jumped on. He's off.
Yeah.
I've gone halfway.
I was expecting a small piggyback. He ran all the way around the courtyard.
Yeah.
We got a video of that. We'll stick that up.
It was only
a little fella.
Can I just say?
I know.
That was actually not Deadpool. Deadpool once had his part of his body chopped off, like half his brain, half his chest, half the side of his body, not any of his legs though, and they regrew the rest of it.
Yeah.
And then what happened was, like, around his penis area, nothing happened, but on his back, just slightly above the spine, a penis grew there.
So it was like,
so he's like free, you know,
I'm doing
inverted commas right now, yeah, quotation marks, free piggybacks, right?
Oh,
but well, actually, kinky. he was just trying to rape you.
So that was a bit uncomfortable.
No, I enjoyed it. It was that uncomfortableness about it. It was all right. I smacked his ass as we was going around the place, whatnot.
Oh, so, apparently, according to you, it was very comfortable.
But obviously, to you guys, that enigma was indecipherable.
Oh!
That's been happening all day. DeadPool puns, get them into DeadPool the usual address.
Awesome.
Address?
Get them into the address. Maybe that could be one of the competition questions. Give us your best DeadPool pun.
Yeah, that could be. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, put in the comments your best DeadPool pun.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can describe them as unintelligible.
No, don't give them ideas.
Yeah, if we say it now, they can't say it later. So.
Give them as many as we fucking can, and it's all up to their imagination to surprise us.
Yeah.
And entertain us.
Yeah.
Because we give you lovely human beings.
Yeah. I thought you was going to try a pun then, and I saw your brain stop ticking.
I was about to offend, but then I thought, you know, like, it would be nice.
It's about the
it would be pole. Wonderful, yeah. Wouldn't it?
Oh. It would
be. In there as well, there you go. Double teamed. You just got double teamed.
So what's your best cosplayer?
I don't know, but it's inevitable that they'll run out. the best cosplayer there, I don't know, there were so many we put up the photos. To be honest with you, I'm that pissed now. After the cocktail party yesterday, I'm so fucked. I can't even remember what happened this morning.
No, but it's far from indescribable, isn't it?
I saw
as the lead singer of Pink Face, Paul, that isn't even a pun, that's just a piss show off.
I saw Bob from Jay and Silent Bob, and no one knew that he was cosplaying. I don't even think he knew he was cosplaying.
Kevin Smith was there.
Undoubtedly, it was definitely
him. Kevin Smith.
Yeah.
It wasn't, he's not here.
The best one I saw was Master Chief, but he built the music into his
thing. So, yeah, we actually got a video and we actually did do an interview with him on the Friday. We found him outside and I filmed it. Chaz interviewed him. He had the American flag and he had all the music.
With the bagpipes. Yeah, we saw him on the way down.
Talking about it's all good, but
we don't.
We've got it.
Here it is right now.
No, they can't. Again, this is all audio.
only if you pause this immediately and go onto YouTube.
So yes, we have got that interview with him. So yeah.
But you know, cutting through all the bullshit. You know, this interview is raw and it's gritty. It's not something for the little ears to be listening
to. None of that stuff is for the little ears.
No. It's really deep and meaningful. I mean, it's basically about this guy, you know, the last war with what were they called? The Horde, the Hive, the Thrive, whatever they were called. You know, those guys, right, that was a heavy job. And after that finished, what did they have to do? You know, what form, what purpose, what reality did they provide within society? Not much. They become veterans. These guys roam the streets in their uniform, in their Master Chief costumes, and they. What do they do?
Answer the question you just asked.
They answer the questions I asked, and that is on YouTube.
Right, so yeah, lots of videos to come, lots of entertaining stuff on the usual places. You can find us at Dem Drunk Blokes on Facebook, Dem Drunk Blokes on YouTube, Dem Drunk Blokes on Twitter, Dem Drunk Blokes on Instagram, although the Instagram account, I don't know what's going on with it.
Dem Drunk Blokes Raw.
Mike McDonald's in London as well, you can find us.
Only Logan.
Dem Drunk Blokes in the location that we're residing in currently, which is...
And if you didn't get that, fuck you.
And DDB presents Catch Up for the Soul, obviously, at Lefty No Hand on your Insta, on Twitch. Your
Yep.
Lefty no hands.
Oh no. See, I'm the same. I'm the same.
Lefty no hands.
Catch up for
Lefty no
And also on the pod bean that you'd always see me just chuck out left, right, and centre one.
Dem drunk blokes.
I'm a DDB comics guy, and if you see the rest of the Good, the Great, and the Logan X, let me know. I've been looking for them for about 3 weeks.
Where is it?
Obviously, Dickface is here. I don't think you're on Twitter, are you, Dickface?
I'm not.
Right. Soon to be DDB Dickface on Twitter.
Right, so yeah, if you want to find me, I'm not on Twitter, I'm not on Facebook, I'm not on Instagram, I'm not on any social networks. You can't find me unless you bump into me, and even if you bumped into me, you wouldn't know it was me because I don't wear a fucking sign saying I'm Dickface. Thank you very much.
Actually, you can find his number in the back of the phone box at King Cross.
Oh, yeah. I put it there as well.
So it's been Piccadilly.
And the guy knows singing is...
Aboriginal
Chaz. Voice guy.
Yeah, so that was the voice guy. You can find him at DDB
Voice Guy. DDB Voice Guy.
On Twitter, although he never uses Twitter anymore because he can't.
I don't use Twitter.
And Chaz Tyson on YouTube, but it'll mainly be on the DDB YouTube channel.
Check out the YouTube feed because that's the one where you can see things.
Yeah. After listening to this, go and look at stuff.
Yeah.
Yes.
Anyway, that's been great, guys. Thank you very much. And I just want to put a shout out to Lefty for actually sourcing the tickets and upsetting. What was her name?
Annie,
the PR rep for MCM. Yeah. If you are listening to this, thank you so much, and we will see you next year.
Woo!
Thank you.
Please go on, girls. Your email address so we can give you digital chocolates.
Yes,
we'll send you digital chocolates.
Yeah. And can you make sure that we all get press passes this time and not anyone just get a little creative pass?
Yeah.
I don't know what is what.
But have fun, guys. Much love.
Say something.
A river down to you, France.
Fuck's sake. Bye.
It's a stereo.
Drunk blokes, they can't walk in a straight line. Their money's in a tight bind. They're driving round the coastline. Damn drunk blokes. They're drinking in the backseat. They're generating bullshit. They're puking on the carpet. Damn drunk blokes. Hey, oh, let's go. Climb into the back now. Where they're going, we don't know. They're all boozed up and ready to go. They can't walk in a straight line. The club will fill a cheap wine. They're hammered out of their minds. Damn drunk blokes. They're drinking in the backseat. They're generating bullshit. They're puking on the carpet. Damn drunk blokes. Hey, oh, let's go. Climb into the back now. Where they're going, we don't know. They're all boozed up and ready to go. They can't walk in a straight line. The bubble's full of cheap wine. They're hammered out of their minds. Damn drunk blokes. They're drinking in the back seat. They're generating bullshit. They're puking on the carpet. Damn drunk blokes. Hey, oh, drunk blokes. Hey, oh, drunk blokes. Hey, oh, drunk blokes. Hey, oh, drunk blokes.